Yeah, I will today talk about the problem of self-action and how it arises and how it is dealt with in the Wheeler-Feynman generalization. So first of all, I want to illustrate the situation. Supposing you have got an electron and that electron is scattered by some photon or some electrodynamic force, then it will go change its direction and go in this fashion. And in all non-relativistic quantum mechanical processes, this sort of scattering is known. But once you bring in relativistic quantum mechanics, then you find that there are other possibilities, and one of them is like this. This is the electron, and then it is scattered in this direction. Now, remember, we have a tacit understanding that time is going upwards. So it looks as if the electron has been scattered backwards in time. But here one brings in Feynman's interpretation of electrons going backward in time, which was derived essentially from Dirac's idea of a positron. So what you say is that this result can be reinterpreted as this. And you can argue that you've got an electron and a positron and they are annihilating, so there is no electron or positron left on this side. But you can have photons coming as a means of conserving energy and momentum. So what you have to remember is that you have got here a situation where you are allowing world lines to bend backwards in time. And this is required in order to understand pair creation or pair annihilation. If you take this way, this, as you can imagine, this can be reinterpreted as this, which means a pair creation. You are creating this, you have changed here from backward to forward direction, so this becomes positron and this is electron. And so you needed some energy to convert them into, convert photons into electron-positron pair. So you have, therefore, a situation where world lines are allowed to bend backwards in time. And that causes the direct particle interaction theories, these Wheeler-Feynman type theories, to rethink what is meant by self-action. So I will explain now. Normally, if you have a world line like this, and you said that two points on this, let us say call them A and A twiddles, they interact. This is what is called the self-action type of interaction. And this is not allowed in the classical Wheeler-Feynman theory. You don't have a particle interacting with itself, but you can have a situation where you can have interaction of this kind, and that is what we have been all the time saying. So if you are looking at this charge, you say that all other charges except itself are going to act on it. Now this interpretation will run into conflict with what we have just now allowed of lines bending backward in time, and it is in the following sense. Suppose you have a line, world line going like this. I have introduced several of those backward and forward thing. So you would say that what does this mean? So you could say that imagine a vacuum producing pairs, and the pairs are electron positron pairs. That would look like this. Now if you look at this as a single world line and you say that self action is not allowed, then it means if you take some null cone, although it intersects this line here, 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 it will say that I am on the same world line, so I am not going to interact with other points. This is what you might think, but theoretically it will be extremely hard for somebody to say whether this interacts or not, because supposing you don't have full information about this line, so you are seeing it like this and like this, and you will say they look different, so they should have interaction. Only when they are made to connect that you argue that no, that is the same line. So what I am trying to arrive at is the confusion that would be created if you push your classical rule into the quantum domain, because you would not know whether a certain pair of lines are going to interact or not. So I can give you one example of this. Supposing you have a positron here and an electron which is going round. This is something like the hydrogen atom. In the hydrogen atom, what you have is a proton and an electron going round it. So instead of proton, I am replacing it by positron. So this thing that I have tried to draw here is what is called a positronium. That is a positron and an electron going around it. Now you could ask this question. Here are two particles interacting. Are they separate particles or they are the same particle? So the way I have drawn it, supposing this is the picture, you will say there are two different world lines, and you can say that therefore they interact, and that is why they are obeying the Coulomb's law and following the usual two-particle interaction. But experimentally it has been observed that the positronium is a short-lived object, and it annihilates itself. That is, E minus and E plus, they annihilate and it disappears into photons. So what it means is that you had this E minus plus E plus in the positronium, they go into two photons, and that means in our picture of annihilation, it is like connected somewhere and then it got annihilated. And so this is therefore one single line by our earlier definition. So you run into this confusion as to are you allowing self-action or not? And saying that you are not allowing self-action is going to give you into trouble like positronium, because here it is one line, so it is self-action because the positronium was relatively short-lived, but an object which existed as an entity in which electron and positron were interacting. So you have therefore a requirement that you always have interaction between two points of a world line. That means this is a self action is back. So now we will see if the self action is back, what happens to infinities. So if you now go to this, back to this. Here you have got a world line with two points A and A twiddles on it, and they are connected by what is called a delta plus function. Now delta plus S square is actually a function which consists of delta function plus the principal part of 1 over S square. So it's a it is obtained by writing the Fourier components of delta function and only taking positive frequencies. Then you will get this with normally it has positive and negative frequencies. So here we can say that if we want to look at self action things, we have to ask how can we avoid self action in the revised circumstances where this kind of interaction is allowed. So the answer is the absorber theory brings about a cutoff in the response of the future absorber as follows, that I will now discuss. But what you do is that you make this A and A twiddles, these two points, they are supposed to be different. So they are not allowed to merge. So you have here this condition that A twiddles and A, they are allowed to come as close as you want, but it should not be made what you call coincident. So that means the separation between the two points has to be finite. So what is the minimum distance you allow for two points on the world line of a particle? This is the question we have to ask. And the answer to this that we thought in 1971 when we are looking at quantum version of Wheeler-Feynman theory, we thought that if we can bring in gravity somehow, then the Schwarzschild radius 2gm over c square r for the electron mass should give us a length scale, and that might tell us that this is the minimum length that you are allowed to approach, and after that you cannot go close, and that will give you a finite cutoff. Later in the 84-85 or somewhere around that, Padmanabhan looked at this from quantum gravity point of view, and he said that the Planck length might be a justification for giving the minimum that you are allowed. But either way, you are going away from electrodynamics. You have to go outside electrodynamics to look for these minimum points. So what I want to illustrate now is a way of arriving at a kind of finite answers by going staying within the framework of Wheeler-Feynman electrodynamics. How can we get a finite cutoff? So first of all, I want to use I need a background cosmology. And background cosmology which works in the Wheeler-Feynman case is the steady state cosmology. This was one of them. So I will work with this to illustrate how one writes it. So here, this is the conformally flat version of the De Sitter line element that you get for from simple transformation. So H is the Hubble constant or the rate of expansion of the universe, and the rest is all coordinates. And frequency, and let us suppose that there is a process, physical process, which has a certain frequency k, and we want to see whether there is a physical limitation on k, maximum value that k can be allowed to have, given the fact that there is an absorber at infinity which is reacting back. So what we do is, first of all, we look at a particular frequency k, and as you send that frequency k into the future absorber, the future absorber will give you a redshifted frequency. So omega is the redshifted frequency equal to 1 minus hr over c into k. So let me just write it here. Now you can see why this is a redshift formula in De Sitter universe. It means that if you start with a frequency and you go a distance r into the future, then the frequency that it will reduce to is 1 minus hr over c. And as you notice, you go a finite distance r, that is the De Sitter horizon that one is accustomed to. So in this case, you can say that the De Sitter horizon puts the absolute limit for any absorber to exist in the future. So here now, let's look at this calculation. So it says the event horizon is at C over H when omega goes to 0. Now, if you shift the absorber, a typical point in the absorber, by a proper distance dl away from the source, then the corresponding frequency will drop by this particular result. This is just simple calculus. And dr, dr is equal to 1 minus hr over c times dl. This is simply the fact that dl is the proper distance and dr is a coordinate distance, so dr is proportional to dl through that 1 minus hr hr over c as the scale factor. So that gives you this result, and at low frequencies in future effective proper frequency at which absorption occurs. Now let us put in some astrophysics into it. If the signal is going into the future, it will interact with particles there, and the typical process that one can think of in a universe of this kind tells you that the effective frequency is given by this formula, where nu is equal to this, where v is the velocity of a typical electron in the future. So this is all taken from astrophysics of interaction. So we continue in this. If we substitute h to the minus 1 as the Hubble value, n equal to the particle density, v equal to this, and omega effective is equal to this, then all these numbers can be substituted to get a numerical feel of it. We'll come back to that soon. So suppose a quantum electrodynamic process lasts between 0 and T. Imagine a local laboratory process, whatever that may be, lasts for a time T, where the time T is large compared to the k to the minus 1. So early oscillations soon after T equal to 0 are absorbed by particles at R equal to Ct, with R given by this. This is using our omega effective, that formula for absorption. And oscillations at T equal to T are absorbed at Ct equal to R. So supposing, like what I am trying to do is the zero to T is the time during which some process is occurring in the local lab, and each of these is going to get absorber response, and we want to include that response in trying to see what happens. So at R equal to T equal to 0, the corresponding R is this, and at T equal to T, the corresponding R is given by this. This is simple light propagation we are using. So if you take these two formulae, look at this one, we know that the horizon is limited by h to the minus 1, what we saw, so R goes to C over h. So if you do that, that this R has to be less than C over h, then Ct minus this quantity must be negative, and we therefore have k less than this particular value. This is a requirement for the absorber to respond to the local disturbance. So if you now substitute the values that we already had before we came to this, we find that you get k equal to quite a large frequency, 2.4 into 10 to the power 31. This is, let's forget it's 2.4, but just say 10 to the power 31 cycles per second. That is the kind of frequency which is an upper limit cutoff for any quantum electrodynamic processes. So what you are saying is that the when you are evaluating any cross section or anything, probabilities etc. from in quantum electrodynamics, you have a natural upper limit of the order of 10 to the power 31, and that should give you various things which is finite instead of infinite. So what one calls mass renormalization normally is to have another infinite integral you subtract from your integral and get a finite value. Instead of that, what you are saying is that the mass renormalization is just if you take a physical process which is measuring the electron mass, then that electron mass process will have a 0 to T limit. And using this, we can work out what will be the extra mass required coming from the response of the universe. And we find that delta m over m is equal to 0.15. That means it's a finite answer. Charge renormalization can similarly be justified using this framework. You find that delta E over E is equal to this much. So these are both finite quantities, not altogether small. It is not as if you are talking of something only in the 10th decimal place, you have got 15%. So there should be some way, experimental way, of are saying how much is the mass correction that we get from the self action integral. So the prediction here is that there should be a finite correction to the mass, and what one talks of are normally bare mass and mass in interaction with other charges. So the difference between the bare mass and interacting mass is delta m, and we are making this kind of prediction. Now here in this connection you will wonder what happened to Lorentz invariance, because I am using a cosmological frame, and cosmological frame is a kind of unique frame. The rest frame in which the universe looks isotropic and similar in all directions. So this means you are talking of Lorentz invariance is violated. So is this a possible drawback of this approach? So the answer to that is that the Lorentz invariance is not necessary in a theory which is global, linked to the universe. So one can quote Dirac. In 1969, he said, with a cutoff, he's talking about quantum electrodynamic cutoff that people normally do. With a cutoff, we eliminate at once all difficulties about divergent integrals, which have been plaguing theoretical physics for decades. These difficulties arise only because people want to have strict Lorentz invariance. So because of demanding strict Lorentz invariance, you are paying the price of infinities. So he says demanding strict Lorentz invariance in an imperfect theory. In doing so, they are aiming for something which may very well be impossible to obtain. So he is saying that the existing approach of having Lorentz invariance in the framework leads you to infinities of integrals, and those have to be removed by artificial means, which is what they call renormalization, and that is what he is saying is should be avoided. That means he calls imperfect theory what we would say is in the present framework that it is an incomplete theory. So the field theory that normally gives rise to charge and mass renormalization, infinite integrals, that theory is incomplete in the sense that it ignores the universal response. Here, if you do go by the route of direct particle theory, you have the universal response coming back, and that of course avoids, that does not allow you Lorentz invariance because you are in the cosmological rest frame, but it is a unique frame in the sense that when you measure the microwave background radiation, you say it is isotropic. It is isotropic only in a particular frame. It's not a Lorentz invariant process. So one should treat this particular thing in the same way. So this is something that I want to emphasize here. The point is both the bare mass and charge are finite. In the standard renormalization approach, what one does is one has a bare mass and bare charge is infinite, and you subtract the correction part, and then you end up with a finite value and you say that is the value that you are measuring. So here the difference is in the both bare mass and charge are finite and additional interacting mass and charge are also finite. So you can in principle talk of what one calls respectable mathematics, not having to do with infinities. So in this connection, again I am quoting Dirac, when he criticizes the standard quantum electrodynamics. Remember that he was the one who originated quantum theory in the basic structure, but he was not in agreement with the way QED went. So he says this so-called good theory, which is QED, involves neglecting infinities, neglecting them in an arbitrary way. This is not sensible mathematics. Sensible mathematics involves neglecting a quantity when it is small, not neglecting it just because it is infinitely great and you do not want it. So he is saying that people normally get rid of the infinities through the subtraction of renormalization approach, and that he says is not sensible mathematics. Sensible mathematics is one where you neglect small quantities rather than infinities. So let me go further. Yeah, this is the one I was quoting. If you want to know the where this quote has come from, it is Directions in Physics, Wiley, 1978, page 36. So Dirac was certainly not in tune with the renormalization program of quantum electrodynamics. What the context? I think they had in this collection some kind of essays on which way physics should go.
1978.
Sorry?
1978.
At that time it was. So what I would call perceptions of different scientists at that time on various problems which were facing people, physicists, they have been in a way put together. So it is not that anybody in particular had a last word in the whole thing, but it is interesting to see what different people thought of the existing way and how to interact and remove it. Okay, now let me. So to summarize this, I want to so one has to ask this question. If you take the field theory, apart from working well in electrodynamics, modulo the renormalization program, which you may or may not like as a part of rigorous mathematics. The field theory has gone beyond what you call electrodynamics. Electrodynamics was a problem in the around 1948 or so, 48, 50, when most of these problems were being handled. Afterwards, it went to gauge theories, and this is all field theoretical approach. So the question is, if you want to say that field theory is not needed, and you go to invoke Wheeler-Feynman theory. So the Wheeler-Feynman theory says no fields. But you need a cosmology. Cosmology.